security in the midst of insecurity. By now, I really hope and trust that all of you have read the 2024 message, State of the Church message, maybe more than one time, I hope a couple of times. To be sure, there are certain things in that message that the Lord said to us that have the potential of being rather frightening if you really read it for how it really, really was. I quote from the message, "Though the nations rage and politicians devise wicked plans, though the mighty fall and the knees of the strong buckle, you need not fear nor be troubled, for I am your Lord, your Redeemer, your Savior. I never sleep. My care over you is 24/7 because I am your faithful Lord." Perhaps of all the encouragement we received from him, the most significant is that the Lord assigned Psalm 27 to us this year, and that's going to be our focus this morning. Disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, we're not called to be normal or natural, but we're called, in all honesty, to a higher place of supernatural living. Yes, the Lord, he wants us to live supernaturally, conscious of his presence, aware of his leading, and confident in his faithfulness. And the only way we can do that is by an uncompromisingly commitment to order every area of our lives by the Word of God. The book of Psalms is very helpful in this regard, for so many of the Psalms, as you know, speak to our individual experiences. David and all the other psalmists express joys and sorrows, confusion and confidence, good and evil was expressed in many of the various psalms. And how precious it was of the Lord to give us a specific psalm, which was originally written by David in a time of national crisis. We don't know exactly what was happening at the time, but the language of the psalm speaks to difficulty, and it speaks very much to stress that was happening at that time. So it's reasonable to conclude that Psalm 27 is written to instruct us how to conduct our lives in a season of history marked by crisis and turmoil in the world around us. So I want to share with you this morning five principles that will separate us from the ways of the world in these scary and confusing days we find ourselves living in. So the five characteristics. Number one, we need vigilance. Now, that simply means being aware of what is going on around us. Be awake. Be alert. Keep a watchful eye. You cannot put your head in the sands anymore, and you cannot be naive thinking everything's going to get better. I can't help who is saying that. I can say it with all the boldness in the world. Everything's going to be all right as we trust God and walk with God. But I did not say everything's going to get better in America or in our situations around us. If we are where I believe and what I think the scriptures point to so clearly, if we are down the road far enough on this trail that marks its way and ends up in heaven for us, on this journey that we're on, it's very obvious then certain things will take place, certain things will happen, and we cannot be naive about it, and the Lord will guide us through every path. Everything, let me state it, is not all right outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the Lord Jesus Christ, everything certainly is all right. We are on our way to meet the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and a glorious day indeed it will be. Psalm 27, verses 1 through 3. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. So in the psalm that we just read, David is keenly aware of what's going on around him. He's not ignorant of the very real threat that he finds himself living in. He was well aware that he was surrounded by wicked people with wicked agendas and that he lived in a dangerous world. But why does he say, in this I shall be confident? That's a pretty strong statement. He declares that though the situation is stressful, knowing that his God is his light and salvation is enough for him to remain confident and overcome the stress. The God with whom he fellowshipped as he watched over his father's sheep, the God who saved him from the towering giant, the God who enabled him to kill a bear with his very own hands. David knew his God would be with him no matter what trial, no matter what difficulty came his way. His God would not leave him. 2024 message on the very first page is words from the Lord saying, I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm with you 24/7. I got you. So we are now in a position with some of the same challenges that David faced. This is where we are today. Are there not in our present world wicked people with wicked agendas seeking to manipulate and control the masses for their own pleasures and purposes? Aren't we in the same life-threatening circumstances as David was when he wrote Psalm 27? If you don't know that, my friend, you're not paying attention, and you too may be caught off guard. You and I have demonic enemies seeking to paralyze us with fear and with dread. But we know that, but for God, this nation is on a rapidly descending slope. And if you don't read the signs, you, my friend, are going to be caught totally off guard. As the Lord's disciples, we are called to know what's going on, but also to see through it and find the hand of God in it. Because God's hand will be in it somewhere. Perhaps some of you have asked yourself, where is the Lord in the midst of what's happening in our world? Well, he's right in the middle of it. That's where he is. Jesus never said that this life would be carefree. Quite the opposite. He said no matter what comes and what goes, he's in the midst of it and he will teach us things. And the teaching of it will be that we will be overcomers. Now, I will remind you, we were taught so many years ago, I don't remember now, that God is in charge, not control. So you need to go ahead and remember that. He's in charge, but he's not in control of everything that comes out of all the evil mouths and all the different things that go on. So therefore, you and I have no reason to fear, but every reason to be vigilant, watching, listening to the Lord, far more than we listen to what the world is doing and what the world is saying, even though we need to know. So the number two thing, characteristic, is confidence. Look at verses 1 through 3 again of the same psalm. Let's read it again. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart will not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. Number two, confidence. Notice that David speaks about fear and confidence in the very same verse. Yes, there's fear, he says, but I'm confident. I'm not going to be afraid because I know my God and I know what my God can do. Amen. It's imperative that you know that. David makes the choice to trust the Lord, and he will not let his emotions rule. His faith rules. Though he is living in a fallen world, David thinks through the implications of the all-powerful, sovereign God that he worships. And he says, since I serve a God who can do the impossible, I need to be more afraid of displeasing him than afraid of what's happening all around me. Amen. Number three, we need to praise and worship. David suddenly shifts his attention from his present trials to the glorious God that he worships. Verses 4 and 6. One thing I've desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle, he shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore, I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. In simple words, this is what he's saying. When trouble overwhelms me, I'm going to let God overwhelm my trouble. Amen. I like that. So David assessed the danger, expressed his confidence, and then he worshiped God. Now, what I just read to you is a simple formula for walking in peace and victory in difficult days. Notice how deliberate David is. He's focused on maintaining a single-minded passion for pursuing the presence of God because he had learned to prepare for the battle before it showed up. Amen. That's what God is trying to do to the church. He's trying to prepare you before it hits you. Number four, we need to be obedient. There is no valid excuse for disobedience. Verse 8 and verse 11. When you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies. Now, here's a picture of David's heart. Did you notice how quickly he responds to the Lord? When you said, I said, is what it says to us. David responded instantly with no hesitation and no procrastination. Number five, we need to be expectant. David says in verse 13, I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Now the question is, did David write this for his fellow Israelites, or did he write it to himself? Either way, it's a precious declaration of expectancy. And it was certainly inspired by the Holy Spirit. This is not the only time that David was expectant. Psalm 62. Truly my soul silently waits for God. From him comes my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He's my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. David says in both Psalms, I know what's going on, but I choose to wait because I expect my God to move in this situation. I have a future, and my God is not finished with me yet. Are you persuaded that God is not finished with you yet? He's not. Are you ready like David to embrace whatever he wants to do in your life? Or are you giving him an outline of what you want to do? Are you expecting him to move in you and through you in whatever time is left before he comes? Out of all 150 Psalms, the Lord chose this particular one for us for 2024. Clearly, it contains truth, insight, and instruction that we need right now, right here, right at this moment. We dare not ignore it. Vigilance, confidence, worship, obedience, expectation. So I close today with the final verse of this absolutely beautiful psalm. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Amen.